Richard will ask if you can agree. Minutes of the committee meeting on 13 June 2017. Were you happy with their accurate record?
Agree.
The standards and constitution of the second committee meeting does include trustees of the Cadiston. We agree with that one, 29th of June. Oversight working group, 29th of June, that was just to establish the mechanism, I think, wasn't it? And then the meeting with the trustees on the 21st of September, and I'm the only person who was. And I agree with myself on that one. Sometimes I don't, you know. And then the special meeting of the standards and constitution of the second committee on the 31st of October, and we agree that they're an accurate record. Any matters arising? Well, I have, because I made inquiries of the introductory law as to whether or not apologies that we requested, that we instructed, whether or not they have been delivered. And the answer I got back from Mr. Cook there's been no apologies.
Sorry, is that up till today, is it?
Well, the deadline was last Tuesday. Okay.
Excuse me, sir, it's not 4 o'clock yet, because the reserve wasn't.
We finished, Jerry.
So as I say, it's just a
we just saw that outlines the complaints that have been received, although we're up to in relation to them and in the past for the previous disciplinary.
Okay, any questions, comments?
And it's at this point, Chair, the question was only in answer.
Okay.
Which is that, as it's been stated, no apologies have been made, and the complainants have contacted us at the end of last week to say they have received the complaint.
And the next question is, where do we go from here?
There's one other question I think that was spoken about when the system changed back in 2012, and we were asked if we need a standards committee, and there's a lot of discussion about whether we needed one or not, because it was basically toothless. And here we have a prime example of showing you.
I think you're right, Phil, Chris. Yes. I don't think any of us who've been party to what's gone on could be more frustrated by the fact that we're not able to actually give to those people who made the complaints that feeling that justice has been done, because it certainly doesn't feel like that at the moment. There is one part of it that she still has the opportunity to comply with, and that is make an apology at full council. We'll see whether that happens. It should be informed in writing that she's required to do that.
Not beyond it being in the decision and in the minutes of the court.
She should write to her, tell her she's got plenty of time to prepare it then.
Yeah, on that point, I was under the impression that the next full council to set the writing would be down on the agenda, where presumably the mayor would advise her to make the apology. That would be the opportunity where she would have to do what.
Perhaps it would just happen if we had clarification about what would happen to the procedure of this committee. Would it go to full council for them to know what's happened? Does it come
there?
Be one of those items that's for noting,
I have less in common, Chair, but because your decision actually involves something to happen at full council, then the way that for that to happen would be for your minutes to be reported to full council, so that full council sees there is an item on its agenda for it.
Okay, I'm happy with that. Yes,
and then Paul. It's not. It's just on the minutes, it doesn't mean there has to be an action to it. If it's just minutes for noting by the council, I think there has to be something a bit more substantial regarding that matter. And the minutes of this committee be reported to the cabinet, so cabinet can make a recommendation to council.
The recommendation has already been made that she, well, it wasn't a recommendation. It's already a recommendation after the standards committee last time that she'd be required, Councillor Chair, to be required to make a formal apology to full council. That's already there. She may not comply with that.
Yeah, that's what I have in mind. Or is it clear that given that the individual was prefabricated throughout the whole process and not complied with anything that's been been requested of the individual, I'm just he's put the subdivision that you may not even show up.
That's good. Just a suggestion, hear what I'm saying, or what I'm saying. Could this not be something that I think Brian suggested differently? Could this not be something in the mayor's announcements that she invites Councillor Louis Frisian to?
Well, there should be part of it.
Does she wish to make the formal apology, and then Councillor Louis Frisian is going to say yes or no?
Okay.
Chair, as it stands, I'll ask Councillor Ivy's question. This is a committee of council. So this committee's minutes, including an item, which will be an item for the agenda of council, would go on the agenda of council. So the agenda of council will be to receive the minutes and note the action that arises So it will be an item. The minutes from the previous meeting will be there, which actually includes your resolution too.
And at that point, the mayor will invite.
Well, hopefully, the mayor will do that.
Can you just, I think you made a call, but there was something else that I thought at one point there was a possibility that the council has the right to censure her by removing her from all committees. And do we have that?
The council doesn't, because whilst in law it's the full council that appoints members to its committees, actually they're done by nominations in the rules. So the power of actually removing somebody or not lies with the groups. It's a bit of a fuzzy area, I have to be perfectly honest. Certainly centralised with the full council. And
so censure, how do you perform these censures?
Exactly that, yes. Okay. A posh way of saying telling off.
That's okay, you don't have to formally move that so we censure.
That's exactly right.
We may well move that at the end.
That's exactly right.
Okay. I'm going to take Paul, because he did indicate that's ever filled, and then go back to you.
It's just to get some absolute clarity. I mean, I would be under the impression that there should be an item on the agenda that specifically is given to Louise Jones to give her apology, rather than it just be open with the minutes. I think specifically, I think we as councillors would want that on the agenda. So that it is open. But with regards to censure, I'm sort of the impression that the correct me if I'm wrong, but the council can issue a statement on behalf of the council. Basically condemn the actions of an individual. We don't have the powers to work with people, we don't have the powers or very few powers to do anything, clearly. So at least the I think that we can do for the victims is to issue a council statement to say that we don't think they have a hand.
Could you do full council and quite happy to do that?
Chairman, in response to the first point, that's essentially what we're saying. So there is the council to receive the report of this committee, and within that is that very clear recommendation that should happen. So it will appear on the agenda in that form. If this committee wanted it worded in a particular way, then this certainly something we would discuss with the mayor. As it stands, to make it very formulaic. On the second point, yes, that's certainly within the power of the council to do that. Normally we would recommend that council doesn't do that unless the member to be censured or plan to be censured is given the formal notice of that and the opportunity of the right of reply, because it is the most serious step.
I think that's some thought.
Can I ask more, is there a case for the cabinet member responsible, including raising a report to council?
Is the cabinet member the
Chair, this is a non-executive function, so it has nothing to do with cabinet. So the closest to it is the chair of the committee. So excuse me. So when it comes to actually presenting this item,
yeah,
in terms of reporting on what has happened in this committee and the views of this committee, on paper, we as officers will do that in a fairly sort of a technical way. The colour to be given is the introduction of the item from the chair.
Okay.
Well, yeah, just on the issue around removing the individual or the individual from the committee. Unless it's a financial penalty, it's a well used of chocolate fire card, because some members may think it's a bonus if they remove from and you don't have to do anywhere whatsoever.
I don't know any member that would think that.
You don't have to do anywhere. Well, obviously not one individual or anything that or more. But that's beside the movement from is they don't have to do anything at all on behalf of the council or for the council. Because that's what you do in working on the county committee. Because you're not working as an individual or as a group member. You're working on behalf of the council.
Well, I think we've understood what our course of action is going to be, haven't we? That the minister wants to be sent to the council and perform the report, and that an invitation will be made by the mayor for her to complete that part of the requirement of that coming out of Labour Standards Committee, and then that I will have something to say as chair.
You would introduce the items.
The items at the start.
If we go back to June, all the resolutions of the panel, as referred to on page 22 of the Mayor of Thoughts, was that the group leader should consider removal of the council from not the committees but also outside bodies. And secondly, the mayor may have or will have a sad announcement to make at council about the council of Smith, and we've got some distance between those proceedings and everyone's announcements and everything else. It seemed to be best for Mr. Court to have these meetings with an item which you might rise upon as chair at that point, if I catch Rhys Jones to say anything. But we have to finesse how the best way to do it is. Council receives the minutes, council to press chair to say are there matters to do with these minutes, the council should consider. And I think we have to go and do it at that point and solve that, I think.
Chair, I recognise the point, which is why this would be separated from Mayor's announcements, because this is an ordinary item of business, if you forgive the term, later down the agenda. So it sits at that point that says receipt of reports from committees, next to the scrutiny committees, for example. This would sit there. So your minutes would sit there effectively as a report. The chair would introduce them, explain what has happened, and say it's before council to allow for that apology. And then the mayor will turn to Councillor Rhys Jones and invite her to do so.
We have to move on and accept that that's the course of action that we take. Right. Item 6 on the agenda is a consultation on doctors' qualification criteria for councillors. And what's your opportunity, sir?
Chair, I think that last conversation blends into the subject of this. So, as pointed out, the previous regime that the local government operated under since the mid-20s disappeared in 2000 to be replaced by code of conduct and statutory tribunals. And that was removed in the 2011 Act with the process that we currently have. Now that has highlighted that gap from what disappeared. So a few other events have happened, the high points as it were. One was a councillor in Cornwall, for example, who made incredibly offensive remarks about children with special needs, but was re-elected after the process of coming to this. And then the most recent being very direct, which is a parish councillor in this case, who had been arrested for sexual offences and was on the sex offenders register. But because that person wasn't sentenced for more than 3 months in prison, doesn't get removed as a councillor. Now, think back to when that item was put into the 1972 Act, which is where it comes from. There wasn't the range of community orders and various other orders that there are now. It was kind of, you went to prison or you didn't. And so there is now this range of offences and offending that means a councillor can be naughty to a fairly large degree without actually being removed from being a councillor. And for example, there is now a fairly healthy list of councillors who have been convicted for housing benefit fraud, for defrauding their own council, but have refused to resign and remain councillors. And so that's prompted the government to issue this consultation paper and ask some very particular questions that are there, 6 questions, 5 straightforward, 1 catch up, which is that 3 months will be sufficient. Should it be changed and should it be used in any other way? Now, if you forgive me, at the end of the report, I picked up commentary from elsewhere and chucked in my own view. And feel free to check it back again. But there is an element here of government reacting to a particular circumstance without necessarily looking at the wider view. And so our prediction, as we did in 2000 as the professionals in this area, and we again in 2011 about the pendulum, is waiting for something to happen so that the pendulum will swing back. And so there is an element, that question 6 on the consultation paper that invites you as members, not only to answer very direct questions that the government asks in proposing this change in legislation, but also allows you to submit any further commentary you might like to do, which is why I put in slightly more expansive talk pieces as well. So, Chair, there's 6 questions.
Well,
I'm going
to excuse you to the first 5 parts and see whether or not there's anything there that we might find too difficult to swallow, and suggested that we would agree with all those and can't believe that the market has now. Are we happy to accept those 5?
Yeah. One lovely example I forgot to mention was a councillor who punched another councillor, was arrested for actual bodily harm, but wasn't sent to prison for 2 months, so they all got to stay as councillors. So those examples are there. That was just one of my favourites.
Just go to show you what's going on out there. We live in a sheltered building, we're all too good.
Have we got comments we'd like to make on that?
Just on those five, Jim, again, I know lines have to be drawn, but when we, the sexual offences, if you're sentenced to prison for life or to a term of 30 months or more, it's an indefinite period. But if you're sentenced to 29 months and 17 days, so there's a line drawn there that would be 30 months you be rather definitely. Maybe 29 months you come back. And I find that difficult.
So are we saying that we have some trouble
deciding? Well, it's just a view that, you know, what's the difference between 29 months and 30 months in terms of you bar for life or the death period or you bar for 10 years? I mean, that I think, you know, if you've done the events, should be an indefinite period for all. I just find it difficult to.
Okay. Does anybody disagree with that? I'm afraid I won't disagree with that. And I think we'll probably make our comment that we think that if somebody has been barred, then it should be for review before they.
Yes. I think this is definitely.
I think this is. It's drawn to fit in the hand, so it doesn't get challenged. Because we're just thinking and then being on everybody, he will jump into the human rights saying, well, why am I in some policies with that offence?
Well, we're not doing that,
that's why I've been drawn that.
But it might, and that's for someone else to decide.
In which case, it'll ignore our comment.
It'll ignore our comment. But it's a comment we want to make is that we believe that if somebody's barred because they've done any of these things, then being allowed to stand again should be subject of a review with the decision, the original decision set aside. Is that possible for us to have that? Do you want me to put it to a vote?
We should make that comment. Should the standard restrictions of a previous inflation be being introduced so the council has to leave to be in council petition?
That's the last question. I'm dealing with the first 5 first. So after the first 5, I think the point that's been made, and I'm asking the committee to accept that we make that suggestion. Whether or not it's one that goes ahead is another matter. But we make the suggestion that if you barred, you have to be subject to review before you readmitted rather than a term, an arbitrary line drawn. Are we all happy with that?
Yes.
Yeah.
And the next thing is some causes.
I hear a slight difference. So the original suggestion was that if someone, for example, was on six vendor register, then they should be considered not to be a fit and proper person to be a councillor, full stop, indefinitely. You, Chair, referred to some review mechanism. So that, that's...
I think Chris was just using sex offenders registered for sex offenders as an example. We could be using the theft or something like that. It's the time that...
If we use the word an indefinite period, that's not part of my burden. That's an indefinite period. It means you can come back at some stage. An indefinite period. Because you're not defined...
It wasn't in relation... You weren't saying it in relation to any particular offence.
Well, I was, because I was talking about the sexual offences, because, you know, if you go to prison for 29 months and 3 weeks, you're only barred for 10 years. It says 10 years, but if you go to prison for 30 months and a week, then it's an indefinite period. Now, what is an indefinite period? And what is, you know, 10 years is 10 years. It's defined. An indefinite period could be 1 year or forever. It's not defined, it's an indefinite period. Who defines what an indefinite period is?
I think, Chair, in the latter stages of that, the indefinite period, there is a review at some point to say
what happens. In which case, let's put a lot of indefinite review.
Equally, there is the question, as you said, Chair, as if there is to be a review in these circumstances, who will do that review? Because there isn't a body in England, there isn't Scotland and Wales. There isn't here to do such a review, to say whether or not someone's a fit and proper person. So in some ways, it's easier to just say,
the structure higher up is inadequate, in our opinion. It's something for them to consider, isn't it?
So there should be created a body to review these.
Well, there should be a higher authority.
Regular thing, depends on the individual and where they deal with it.
problems we have running out to do with anything.
Exactly, and these are the points of, these are the points that have been made by Mr. Court,
yeah.
Not part of the consultation.
No, I think that they are very valid.
They are.
Should be supported, whereas we should be asking that, because that consultation, what council can we advocate?
And my suggestion is that we include in our response in the consultation a piece saying we do believe that the council should have the powers to punish a member who has done something either so serious as to require some action or who has a persistent offence. So you have a cumulative impact of what people have done or an offence which is so serious. And we should have powers to suspend a member either temporarily or until the term of the next election.
I think
you
should adopt, any totality that the federal laws running commentary to the last session or
can do it.
Chair, what I've picked up from that is that on the list Jean was referred to, which is about the scope of your powers for certain actions. Such as recklessly disclosing information to people, all those things that actually aren't covered should lead you to be able to temporarily suspend the person, potentially up until the point of the next election. And those are powers to show to the public the degree to which you as a councillor would take seriously and deal with the person whose standards of behaviour stray so far as to not be a fit and proper person to act as a local councillor.
What's the scope? What's the time scale for this?
6th of December.
Right, so when will they publish their findings?
It should be, because this was a very pressing press issue, because it was on the front pages of the papers. So it's a politically warm, so I would suggest it would come back fairly quickly. And obviously, as ever, members, because it's an open consultation, the only person can.
I think we should have some more powers. Big concerned about having the powers to suspend until the next election, not because of concern about that power, but you could be suspending someone for 3 years, 11 months. If they offend badly in the first month of the election, you're going to suspend them until it's 4 years' time. That's a huge suspension.
You'd have to use that discretion.
But I'm saying that if you suspend
them, that's what I'm saying. Yeah, I mean, it would depend how seriously you view what they've done at the time you impose the sanction. And you suppose you'd have to take that into consideration. It isn't really to indicate that there are occasions when the council say this person and the way that they've behaved are not fit to be serving people in this borough. Now, that might change over the period of time. The electorate might say they want them to serve, but it is a marker that I get through. But you could only use that in most
I realise that, but you know, the individual could just stand out from their group and act as an independent councillor and carry on serving the people, even though they've been suspended.
That couldn't be the case, could it? They could do that at the moment. If they were suspended by the group, they could do that, I presume. But if they were suspended by the council, and they're suspended from the council, aren't they? They couldn't do that.
Mr. Case, to pick up Councillor Blakely's point, that's a reason why at least one council has written and said they would like a for want of a better word, a right of recall, in effect, to call a by-election and put those people to the ballot.
So we're not the only ones
The key issue is the electorate probably perceive us as fairly toothless or powerless in the face of certain circumstances. In order to have public confidence in a system of checks and balances, we need to go further than is suggested in the paper. Clearly, the offences that are outlined in the paper are ones that would be total public opprobrium for, but somewhere outside that. It's a range of things where people have failed to fulfill their duties, which is, I think, referred to the real issue of recall, which the report's touched on in section B. Well, certainly, agree. If anyone listens to the archers currently, they'll know the SNPs are back often. So you would have people who are fraudsters in various walks of life. And it often occurs to me that if there are a member of the council whose business dealings are a bit suspect, that led them to be in certain hot water, shall we say, then they would be also regarded as unfit to carry out public duties. But how you pour that public opprobrium onto them as if those persons have the brass neck simply to tough it out and fulfil all their term of office till the day they cease to be a councillor, just as duties, unless they're locked up for something. So a power of recall would seem to me put it into the hands of the electors in that community. How would be triggered? The DCLV think of some rules. You could have 10 very unhappy people, probably all about 10 unhappy people. But there would be a point at which it was triggered, so that there's clearly a view on behalf of the electorate in a particular community that the members should be disenfranchised or recalled in some way. And therefore, that seems to me the most a good section. There are people in various walks of life whose business dealings might suggest to the electorate that aren't they a physical person to be involved with overseeing their money, but who might not end up before the courts. But at the same time, maybe unscrupulous.
Well, that's why we've got code of conduct.
If you went down the recall route, the DCLG would have to go for some trigger mechanism.
Yeah. But in principle, we're not averse to that.
Oh, averse to that,
yeah. I suggest maybe one sort of alternative is the right of recall sits. With a panel like this, so one of the options, one of the sanctions, as it were, would be not to disparage of being a councillor in the way that had previously, but actually to trigger a violation.
Okay.
Yeah.
That must be a political game, wouldn't
we? We have to make sure that the Standards Committee was always as impartial as it showed itself in the last few months.
Greater confidence in the council and to allow the council to deal with persons, to show the public the degree to which a person whose standards of behaviour has stayed so far, isn't to no longer be putting that person to act as a legal counsel.
Can I just, I think that's great. Just talk about a scenario where somebody is, you move in the council, but they stand again, either with the support of their party, because they can give it back, or they put it in the council, and they are already elected. Then they're back on council. And everyone's support is gone.
Jay, that's very possible outcome, and I was bearing in mind that certainly at the time in 2011 that came in, it was very much the Secretary of State's and the government's view that rather than standards, the power should lie in the hands of the people in the ballot box, and therefore, if they wish to elect a scandal, then the scandal they will have. But there is a gap there in terms of the council being able to do something into it.
Okay. We'd like to move on. Okay, we're going to move on to the last item of the agenda, which is the work programme. We don't seem to have any details of our working party, just on the council. Go on, I didn't take over of two of the council. I'm just sorry to go back to the minutes. Are we ready to sign that off now? The council, that order should be transferred. I did contact Colin about it. Okay, work programme. We've got a list under item 7, we've got a list of topics that we've agreed, and I suppose the first thing we could do is to prioritise those as to which one we want to start with first and then move through. My suggestion is that we start with filming the meetings. I think that would be quite a short one, the advantages, the disadvantages, the practicalities of getting it off the ground. I mean, we have got to the point before where we said we would move ahead with this, I think. There's an allocation of funding to do this, so I think it would be a good thing if we had a session of the working party to formulate a plan to see whether or not we're going to move that forward now and a time scale for that. So we've got the working party agreed, members of it. I wonder if we can set a date for us to meet and have a session on this. Everybody agree on that?
Agree.
Chair, if I just comment on the work programme. One of the things I was asked to look at when I came, because obviously I'm here as an interim and here for a relatively short space of time, but just to, because of my background is in constitutions and constitutional law, so for example, the Liverpool City Region, their constitution was